You are welcome. I'm excited this morning coming to share thoughts with you on Me and You Christian Relationship Foundation. And I want to thank God for today. This is Easter period. We're talking about the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ that give us a sense of direction and purpose for living. I want to say thank God for your life, that as we are seeing this experience and we are seeing it, we experience it. And by the grace of God, that resurrection power become a part of us to bring out the best in our life. You are welcome to Christian Relationship Foundation Family Life. I'm here in the studio, as usual, with my girlfriend, the only woman in my life. And I want to thank God for our life too. How are you, baby?
Thank you.
How do you do?
Myself.
You are fine?
I'm
okay. Okay, I know I love you. A good woman. Like when I, many times when I say you're a good man, people surprise, because anything that is good cannot do you bad. Because you cannot have hot and cold water coming out from one part. You have to be a good man. So by the grace of God. That is, her name is Grace, so I just decided to marry Grace. And when God now adds his grace, become a double blessing. Now we'll be looking at how your marriage can be successful. And we today we are going to be talking about building a happy and a long-lasting marriage. Building a happy and a long-lasting marriage. Now, the negative aspect of what is happening in other people's marriage should not be your focus. You know, a lot of us, we tend to focus on, oh, look at what happened to so-and-so person. So that is why so-and-so thing is happening. No. You should dwell on the good side of it. Dwell on those that have succeeded. There are bad drivers, bad mechanics, bad television presenters, bad this, bad that. There are also good ones. Why not copy the good one, and that will make you, if there's any word like that, that will make you gooder. You become the gooder in the good environment. So the Bible says, whatever thing is good, whatever thing is lovely, whatever thing is of good report, think on these things. Let your thought dwell on the side of life that is good. Don't dwell on the negative aspect. You know, a lot of people have testimony. Oh, look at the other person. People will make reference to the failures. They will not make reference to the success. So we are talking about how you can build. And building simply means you have in your mind like a construction site. When you are in a construction site, yes, the construction site is not always beautiful at the foundation. And I want to tell you, that is why so many marriages, when you enter, they say for better, for worse. I want to let you know, in my short time on earth here, I found out that it's always the worst that comes first. That the foundation is not beautiful. A lot of people want to have a finished experience. You can't have a finished experience until you finish strong. You must have the foundation experience. The foundation experience might be ugly. Your beginning might be small. As you build, as you make progress, put the block, precept by precept, you lay this block, you move on, you lay this. All those things, as you begin to build, it become beautiful. Now, I'm talking about my girlfriend. We didn't start our life like this. I remember when we got married, we're not even having enough money to even push our wedding through. We went through so many things, and these are the things that is stopping a lot of young people from getting married. A lot of you are looking for already made husband, already made wife. Already made husband has already made problem. Already made wife have already made problem. There are process God will deliver to you at your foundation, raw material. God does not give you a finished product. He always gives you raw material. What you do with that raw material, how you cook it, how you present it, because the road to success is always under construction. Construct your own. I remember as we were preparing for this meeting, I was looking at when I got married to my wife. I just have a bench. You remember? It was just a bench that somebody gave to us in church, and among the bench, that was what I have in my parlor. There was nothing. There was no chair. Then the boy I was trying to help pack all my things and ran away. When I got married to my wife, she brought the tape where we were playing my CD, everything. The boy took it away. I'm talking about precisely 25 years ago. But the story is different now. For every glory you see, there is a story behind it. Be ready to build your own. A lot of you want to start, you want to enter into marriage, you want to start big, or you want to start from a duplex. If you are a young person, you are married at the age of 25, at the age of 30. I know some of you that are 40 think you are still young. I'm sorry for you. If you think you are 40, you are not married, you are still young. I'm just asking, you are an old man. By now, you should be preparing for your grandchildren. But if you start late, you should be ready to
to continue with it. You know, now all of those things that happen, you pay the price for it. You walk towards it. Everything you see is built by some men. I want to read the Bible verse that I believe will bless you. Take your pen, take your pencil, take your biro, take paper, call your friends and ask them to tune and listen to this, because we are going to take it. And in case you have any question, you can send a text message or via WhatsApp to those numbers that will be appearing on your screen, and we will respond to it, if not today. But it's going to be a great teaching. This teaching, we are talking about building a happy and a long lasting marriage. I'm not talking about a marriage that will take you for a lifetime. God does not intend for you to divorce. Divorce is not the mind of God. God hates it. If God hates divorce, we should hate it too. So I want to look at what the Bible says in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 4. I think Hebrews 3. Yes, thank you. Hebrews 3 verse 4. I want to take it from the King James Version. It said, every house is built by some men, but he that built all things is God. Every business, every organization, every state, every country, in whatever environment, anything you see that is doing well, people build it. But not everybody, some people. And I want you to be among those that build their marriage. Like I said, marriage like a construction site. Now, if you don't walk well in construction site, you don't wear the necessary boot, they can choke you. And they didn't set it for you, it's because you are in the site. Now, if they are walking and you don't do well, you go to follow where capital is walking, the wood can hit you. It did not intentionally, it's just because you are in the site. Now, all of those bruises will come because you are in the site. So I want you to take your time, even as my girlfriend, my helper, and how many things do I even call yourself? My good girl, my good wife, the mother of my children, the most beautiful wife that God has revealed to me to marry. When I say God revealed, I didn't mean God wake me up and I went, I choose this one, it's my choice. Because God told you, you choose. And once you have choose, you stay with what you have choose, your choice. So I she will start it, but we are looking at building a long master marriage. Hello, girlfriend. So where are we going to start?
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, so happy Easter in advance.
No, we are in Easter. It's not in advance. We are in Easter.
Always listening to this Me and You family life. We are here just to make sure that our marriage will work out. And then what we are talking today is building a happy and long lasting. It's possible for you to be in a marriage and you are not happy. So what we are saying today, you want to be happy in your marriage. And being happy is not only about money. Because most guys are people believe that, oh, when I have money, then I should be happy. It's not only about money. It's only about fulfillment. Once you are fulfilled in your mind, you are happy with what you have. You are happy with the wife you married. You are happy with the husband you married. I tell you, with time, with the process of time, they begin to see the beauty of that man, the beauty of that woman begin to show up. And both of you begin to stay together. So in building a long-lasting marriage, there are some things we need to know that we are going to be discussing. And one of them is love the person you marry. Love the person you marry. Love the person you hope you marry. You know, it's two different things. The person you have married, now just love that person. Not the person you would have seen, maybe your ex and all those ones you married. Accept your spouse totally. Accept your spouse totally. You cannot love a man or woman you do not accept. Stop comparing your spouse with anyone. He or she can never be somebody else. Until you accept your spouse, you cannot get the best out of your marriage. Accept what you are. Accept the husband. Don't say, if I was not, I just married Jumbo now. The husband is not Jumbo. The husband is Jumbo. Oh, if I just married to a Simon. Oh, the husband is not Simon. The husband is Joshua. Why not accept what you have? Because if you accept a thing, you cannot see the beauty of that thing. If you go to the market and you want to buy a dress, if you don't love that dress, I tell you, you are not going to pay for it. What makes you to pay for the dress is because you love it, you like it, and it will fit you. Is okay for you, and then you go after it. So the same thing in your marriage. The person that you have married now, accept that person.
love that person. That is who that person, and begin to build and mold that person to suit what you want. At the beginning, the person might not suit, you know, there are some things that is still, you know, my husband was talking about when you are in the construction site. You see, when you are at the site, you are building, there are times you lay the block, it's like you discover that it does not suit what you want. You pull it down, you remove all things, it fits what you want before you can leave. So also in marriage. So in doing that, it's not with fighting, it's not with quarreling, it's just to be able to make the person understand that this is what and what you should do that will make us actually have, you know, a fulfillment. So love your wife, love your husband, accept the person that you marry. The person might not be educated, the person might not be exposed, the person might, you know, no matter what you see in that woman and what other things you want to see, you are the one that will draw it out. The Bible says, draw water out of your well. So the woman is your well, the husband is your well. Draw water out. What you want to see? What is that you want to see in your husband? You want to see? We are both here today. We didn't start like this. The whatsoever you are seeing us today did not just begin like this. We started from somewhere. You know, sometimes no one want to make fun, I just ask my husband. I didn't know that my husband can be so fat like this. Wow. I didn't know that there are some flesh that is in it, because you need to see when we got married, you know. But you appreciate, because you appreciate what you have and you are ready to stay with what you have, the best begin to come out. Mm-hmm. Both of you begin to work together, because why? You are on a journey. Marriage is a journey. And as you begin to take one step after the other, the beauty, the thing begin to unfold. You begin to see the beauty of it. Like when someone is talking about an onion, you know, when you hold an onion at the beginning, you discover that it is sometimes it's looking somehow. But as you begin to remove the back, begin to see the beauty of what you want, begin to come out for you to use to cook. The same thing with cabbage. At the initial, it's like it's a leaf. Oh, but as you begin to remove it, then what you want to use to eat to begin to, so also marriage is, begin to remove those tongues as you are building, remove those tongues, remove those things in love. And I tell you, you see the best. You don't need to compare your husband. Oh, if I marry Jumbo, if you wear this, it's not Jumbo. Now that is Simon. Walk with Simon and bring out the best in Simon. Or walk with Grace and bring out the best in Grace. And I tell you, you have a long-lasting marriage.
Wow, that's exciting. I know, as we were just talking, I was looking at some Bible verse, you know, as Christians, the Word of God is the mind of God revealed to us. Mm. The Word of God is the mind of God revealed to us. So whatever we are talking about, we are looking at what said the Word, what said the Scripture, what did God say? Because a lot of people, they are allowing their tradition to govern their marriage. Mm. Now, once you allow your tradition and your culture and your religion, because Christianity is not religion, Christianity is a lifestyle. A practical lifestyle. If you cannot apply it, you will not get the best. Religion is people looking for God. I'm not looking for God. In me, in Him we move, in Him we live, in Him we have our being. Jesus lives in me. Jesus talked through me. Jesus walked through me. So it's very important for us to know, until we begin to live by the standard of God's word, we cannot have the best that God has for us. I want to read the Bible verse to drive home what we are sharing with you on: love the person you marry, not the person you hope to marry. You know, there's a parable in my play that you don't barb hair on behalf of person that is not around. If you want to barb hair, you bring your hair to the barbing shop. So you cannot say, okay, I'm not around, barb my hair for me. No, your head need to come. So if you are going to grow and see the best in your married life, you need to do it. And if you don't do it, you can't eat it. The doing of it is in the eating of it. If you don't do it, you can't eat it. And God is not a respecter of persons. If you dare to apply the word of God, to work for you, to just work for you. And I'm reading from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. He said, husband, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he may sanctify, clean it, with the washing of water by the word. Use your word to present your wife to yourself. Speak good word. Marriage is sustained by word, not by check. When I was getting married to my wife, I did not write a post-dated check so that she can have hope or a future. It was my word. And I said, I love you and I want to marry you. I believe that with God we can succeed. And today we are going to 25 years this year. And we are so happy and grateful to God that we have met each other. And I want to tell you this, without making mistake, if we come back to this life again, if there's a reincarnation, I won't even want to marry somebody else. I will want to continue with my wife. You know why? Because of all the investment I have put in, I don't want another person to reap my harvest. You know, I just want to continue from where I am. Now, look at what it said. By the word, that you may present it to yourself, a glorious church, not having spot nor wrinkle, nor any such things, but that it should be holy without blemish. So ought a man to love his wife as his own body. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. So if you know something happened some days ago, my wife, there were some decisions I wanted to take, and I really wanted to take those decisions, but if I take that decision, it will affect me. And the reason, because my wife is involved. So I was dilly-dallying. I couldn't take that. Why? Because she's part of me. If I take it, I will hurt myself. So I needed to talk so that we can sit down and talk and discuss it. Now, listen to me. Until you see your wife as part of you, you will think that whatever you are doing, you are getting to her. No. My wife answered my name. My wife carried my children for 9 months. My wife will stay in the same house. No matter how close you are to me, you are not as close as my wife. The part of me, I share part of me with my wife. Two of us are one. Just like the two eyes we have in our head, we can't see two things, we can only see one thing. So if we see two things, our eye, it simply means our vision have problem. That is it. Anytime two of you are seeing two things, there is division. And where there is division, there is no progress. And look at what it says here. It said, you have to love yourself. So loving your wife is actually doing yourself a favor. You're actually doing yourself a favor when you love your wife. You're actually doing yourself a favor as a woman when you submit and respect your husband. Because when you respect your husband, you bring out the best in him. When you love your wife, you make your wife submission become easy because she has something to submit to. Submission is not in vacuum. Submit to love, and respect will follow. So it's very important, and I'm reading this Bible verse. It said, for no man yet hates his own flesh, but nourish it, cherish it, even as the Lord, the church. It's very important because the church is a she, is the bride of Christ. Christ is a man. The church, God relates to us as a woman. So he's talking about how does Christ relate to us as the body of Christ. It's very important as a believer that you know that whatever you are doing to your wife, to your husband, you're actually hurting yourself. So why will you hurt yourself? You need to take care of yourself. Now that is why self-love is the manifestation of the real fulfillment in marriage. Because a man cannot vomit what he has not eaten. So if you really want to love your partner, love yourself. Because if you love yourself, with that same love you love yourself, that's what will radiate and impart your partner. So if you self-love is the beginning. So those of you that are looking for love from the outside, self-love is first. Because if you love yourself, then it's easy to extend it. Because you cannot vomit what you have not eaten. So it's very important as a believer that we should practice self-love. When you love yourself, the Bible even told us, love your neighbor as yourself. There's another Bible verse I will want to look at. You say, we are reading a lot of Bible verse. Yes, because that is where our authority comes from. I'm reading from Luke chapter number 14, verse 28, and we'll read to 31. Luke 14, because we are looking at not comparing yourself with somebody else. Love yourself. Luke 14, verse number 28. And then look at what it says in that Luke 14, 28. It says, for which of you intend to build a town, seated not down first? And this is where a lot of people have issue in marriage. Whatever you are doing, discuss with your partner. You know, some people have this erroneous belief. Not everything that they tell woman, not everything that they tell a man. If you don't tell your wife, you don't tell your husband, who are you going to discuss? You think you are going to succeed in it? A house divided against itself, house cannot stand. So he said, sit down first. Why will you sit down first? You know, quantity severe is one of the things that give you that strength to build. I remember when we were building our when we started the building in our church and the school and all of those stuff, we want to take that building 5 years or 6 years ago. I remember the first thing we did was to take the bill, get the bill of quantity. Now that bill of quantity now reveal how much do we need to start to finish. Even though we don't have that money all at once, we have an idea how much the building will cost at the end of the day. Even though there is inflation, whatever, you can't go less. And moreover, there was some things they put in it. And if you manage, properly, you find out that you might not spend, but it gives you an idea on how much you are going to spend. So with that, the same thing with marriage. Why will you just go into a marriage without first of all sitting down? Check this woman, what kind of appetite does she have? This man, what are what? Both of you need to sit down. Unfortunately, we see in marriages today, a lot of people plan their wedding, they don't plan their marriage. Now, how dare you enter into marriage without planning? You need to sit down, plan. How many children do we tend to have? How are we going to take care of our children? And this work that we are doing, when are we going to stop? When do we build our house? All of those things, a sum total. That is why it's good for you to have a plan. Because actually, as a man, if you don't have a plan, your wife is a helper. He has no need to help you to fulfill. Because a woman comes into your life with equipment. God equipped them to be able to help you. It's not good that a man should be alone. And I want to tell you something. Now, if it's not good for a man to be alone, it's not so good for a woman to marry a man that does not have plan. Now, until you have a plan, when the wife comes, it will be able to help you to fulfill your plan, because two of you work together as a great team. So it's very important. Look at what it says. First, not counting the cost, when he suffered to finish it. What's how it will finish it? Lest it happen after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it. All that behold it begin to mock him. And there's a lot of people today, your marriage is a mock. Why are people mocking you? Why are people mocking your marriage? How dare you enter into marriage without plan? He said, no, God just give us the key. Only you born. Tomorrow born. Next week born. Born. Before you know, you're almost catching fire because of born. Now, you have to have plan for your children. The children you want to have. How do you tend for their education? What is happening? What are your plans? Now, listen to me. Until you plan, God can't bless. God will not bless you in vacuum. No, you have to plan. God will have something to bless. You bring your plan before God, and God bless your plan. And say, my son, it's a good plan. Because it is the plan of God that you be fruitful. But to be fruitful, it's like eating. You must know what your tummy can contain. If you eat too much, it will kill you. There are other people that are eating and have died. I don't know if you watch those programs. Somebody will come and eat and die there. So it's very important for you to know. It's very important for you to know that if you don't finish, you will people will make mockery of you. 30 says, this man began to build and was not able to finish it. Finishing is very important. Finish strong. I want you to finish strong. I want your marriage to do well. For you to be happy, you need to have a plan, and you will see your progress, and you see things working. If it's not working, you and your wife will come back to the drawing board. Honey, we need to do this. Darling, we need to do this. What do we need to do? That is how you're married. It's a walk. Because you see, as you marry, you bring children into this life, you teach the children what you know. After you are no more, your children continue from there. Because you see, this life is a continuity. And everyone that comes into this life, it will die one day. And that is why I tell my family, my greatest motivation is death. I know I will die one day. So if I know I will die, what kind of life am I going to live? How will I live my life? Knowing that I will exit this place one day. It's very important as married couple, we work together as a team, we build our plan, we work our plan, we talk our plan, we dream our plan, we pray for our plan, and we begin to move forward. Even our children will be part of our plan. You see, when you have a long-lasting marriage, your children begin to see you as a reference point. Your children can reference and say, oh, daddy and mommy used to, daddy used to, mommy used to. They reference to you. What kind of life are you building today? Can your children make reference to your life? Can your children see your marriage as a reference point? Can they relate to it and have a great future? Can they say, thank you, God, forgiving me a father or a mother like this. It's very important as you listen to this program that you begin to have a rethink. Don't compare your life with another person. A lot of time, the reason why you don't have value for what you have, because anytime you compare, you lose it. You know, you lose it. Who told you are not blessed? The reason why you think you are not blessed, you are using the other man. You are using the other man as a yardstick to compare. I'm blessed. I'm blessed to have a wife. I'm blessed to have children. I'm blessed to have a home of my own. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I'm blessed. And so you are. Begin to have focus. If you don't have focus on what God has blessed you with, you lose value. That is why you don't have time for your wife. You don't take your wife out. You don't appreciate your husband. And a lot of people at the end of the day, when their husband or wife is no more, you see them crying and yelling and making all of those noise and begin to shout. You didn't know your wife will leave you one day? You didn't know your husband will leave you one day? I want you to know that when you plan, both you and your wife, you have good stock in your memory bank. When your wife will remember, you say, oh, bless the Lord for the type of husband my wife was when he was here. Bless the Lord for the type of my wife was, or a man that you have given to me. Today, I am blessed. My wife lost her father during the course of this week. But we thank God for the life that he has spent. I want to use the opportunity to say, God will console the family and take care of everyone that is concerned. I want you to know, once you are in this life, you will exit this life one day. No? That's it, my darling. And we just go. I want to use the opportunity to say, we will console you and say, God will give you strength. And
thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Abia. Thank you for always listening to this program. That's just it. Don't use somebody else's success or marriage to judge your own marriage. When you are able to accept what you have, then the best will come your way. And then the second thing we want to look at is understand each other. Understand each other as couples. No marriage succeeds without understanding. Learn to know one another as best as you can. Mm. Understand you are not the same and may never be. Respect that you are both individuals. Get to know each other's strengths, weaknesses. Strengthen each other's weaknesses. Mm. And what do we mean by understanding each other? It's very, very important. Most time people go into marriage, the reason why they are having, you know, crack in their marriage, having issues, challenges, sometimes we don't even take time to study ourselves. Mm-hmm. You need to, because the woman you marry when you are in a relationship is different from now that you are married. The man, the same thing. So you need to spend time to be able to study yourself. What are the things that my husband will want me to do? What are the things he will not want me to do? What is my husband's strength? Because we are all different. And your wife cannot be you, and you cannot be your wife. You are two different individuals, you know? And so when you appreciate that and accept that, we are not the same, and we can never be the same. The way I do things is different from my husband, the way you do things. Because our temperaments are different. So, and because our temperaments are different, so we can never be the same. You discover that there are some men, they are only just to give. Why the woman is the other side she's security conscious, trying to protect the house, the family. So, or the man is able to, okay, this is the reason why. So, the two of them kind of, why sometimes also the woman that like giving, try to help, but why the man is conscious of tomorrow, you know? So, when those two individuals marry, they begin to study themselves and begin to know how to fit into each other so that at least their marriage can work out. So you need to study your partner, very, very important. Some people will be wedding today, and after wedding, it's not just all about I want to have children. Yes, children are good in marriage because the Bible says that God will definitely bless your marriage. Children will come. But before the children comes, or while the children are there, you need to spend time to study. There are some things that I know that my husband will be doing. There are some things somebody will come at me and say, I know that my husband cannot do this. Because why? I took time to study my husband. You know, when we are 20 years in marriage, and my husband asked and said, what are the things that have kept us to this time? I told him, number one thing is understanding. Number two thing is understanding. Number three thing is understanding. I said, that is what happened. We just understood ourselves. That this is what I should not cross my boundary. as a woman, know your boundary in your husband, in your home. As a man, also know that there are some things you are expecting. You are expecting so much from your wife, and she's unable to do it. Don't put pressure under her to that extent that you cannot be able to get her best, but rather she'll be making mistakes. So, but help the woman or the man to be what you want, actually want that person to be, by understanding. With understanding, you can be able to build a long lasting marriage when you understand your when. So when you don't know your husband's weaknesses, you are married. You say, what is it? Say, I don't know. What is the strength? I don't know. Then you are not a wife. Then same thing with the man.
It's not a wife, it's a knife.
So you are not a wife, you are just a stranger
knife.
In that house. So if you are a man too, and then somebody, what is your wife's weakness? What are those things? Say, my wife weakness. I don't know. Okay, what are her strength? What are the things you know that she can do and do it very well, and she's happy in doing it? You say, my wife, I don't know. Then you are a stranger in that home. So as husband and wife, take time to study. When we got married newly, sometimes there are some things I will just do. I want to see my husband's reaction. So, and when I do it, I see his reaction. I know that, okay, this one does not actually go down well. Then what will I do? I retrieve my step. I will not do it again because I know that he does not like it. So the same thing as a man, as a woman, for you to understand yourself. And then let's look at a Bible verse here to be able to portray what we are talking about. 1 Peter 3:7. Let's look at 1 Peter 3:7. 1 Peter 3:7. My version says, also each of you husband must live properly with your own wife. You should understand properly what she needs. She is not as strong as you are. So you should remember that you should be kind to her. Remember that God has promised the same thing to both her and you together. He has promised that you will live with him always. So you must be kind to your wife, and then nothing will stop God from answering what you pray for. Do you understand that? So nothing will stop. You must be able to be kind to your wife. Know that she's not as strong. You know, some people say, women are weaker vessel. Women, it's not that a woman cannot be a weaker vessel when she carry a pregnancy for 9 months and then she deliver. But just understand your wife that there are some things she can do, there are some things that she cannot. As a woman, there are some risk a woman cannot take. But as a man, God have designed for that. Men are risk takers. Our aim is to support the man for taking the risk in prayer and then in encouragement. Encouraging the man. Don't say, forget about what we are hearing today. You know what a man can do, woman can do. It's not true. It's not true. I'm not in that era of say what a man can do, woman can do. A woman can even do it better. Mm-mm. There are some things a woman cannot do. God did not design like that. So our own is to help the man. That does not also mean that a woman should be lazy. But there are things that you can be able to do. You go ahead and do what you can do. And leave the man to do what God has also designed him and built him to be able to do. I say, look at your mate. Your mate are doing this. Yeah? Your mate is this. Your mate are carrying this. Your mate are doing this. Your mate are... We can be mates, but we are not grace mates. We all have our different abilities and different grace that God has graced us to be able to function in our area they have designed us to be. So just understand what your wife is designed. Oh, look at this person. He's doing this. You are just there eating my money. You're just eating my money, watching my television. Is your wife designed for that? Look at what your wife is designed for. If I want to go to office and come back, if I want to do business, set up, whatsoever you know that is designed for, do that, and then you will see, you will live. That means you will be happy, and you have a long-lasting marriage. Thank God for my husband to just allow me to be who I am.
Thank you.
For making me to be who I am. He just there, and I just function in my area. And at the end, we come back home and we are all happy because everybody is functioning in his own area of God have given him an assignment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because if you want to have the best of the thing, you must understand it. The day you don't have understanding of whatever product, any product,
If you want the best of any product, the first assignment you have is to study the manual. Now, when you read the manual reveals what is the mind of the manufacturer. Now, once you know the mind of the manufacturer, you have the best and the maximum use of that product. But if you just throw away the manual, you can only learn some few things, and a lot of things you cannot learn. So it's very important. Understanding is the basis for fulfillment and satisfaction in marriage. Understanding, acceptance. First of all, accept. Don't compare your husband with somebody else. Accept who you have married. Because let me tell you, there's always a tendency that after you are married, you now see somebody else that you think that is dark and lovely. You know, because the reason why, because you are inside this and now you don't longer see. It's like somebody wearing perfume. You know, when you wear perfume, you no longer smell the perfume like it used to be the first time. You think that the perfume is no longer powerful. That's why a lot of you can empty one bottle on your dress, thinking that the thing will come around and it become offensive when you move. So it's very important for understanding. You want to have the best of your marriage understanding. I want to read the Bible verse to you in the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 2, verse 17. You're talking about Moses here. And the shepherd came and drove them away. But Moses stood up and helped them and watered their flock. That was what gave Moses a wife. When the man came, drove everybody away, Moses came up with strength. You see, the woman was not able to fight, but Moses came and fought. And when Moses fought and drove them and fetched water, and she now went, took the flock back home. And father said, you came early today. He said, an Egyptian help us. You must know your wife's weakness if you want to have the best. If you must know your husband, every man has a weakness. Every woman has a strength. Sometimes, just like what my girlfriend was saying, you might be strong in some area. You discover that area. Allow your wife to function in that area. Then while you are strong in this area, allow your husband to function in that area where you know you are weak. That's why two of you are the same. We are all work in progress. And I tell you something, the journey to success, the road is always under construction. And God will not give you a finished product. He gives you a raw material. Your husband is your raw material. Your wife is your raw material. No man gave birth to a wife for you. Every man gave birth to her daughter. Every woman gave birth to her son. But when you are now married, the husband you want, you are the one to draw it out. The wife you want, you are the one to draw it out. The type of wife that you want is your job as a man. That is why they are calling you bridegroom. You are grooming your wife. Bridegroom. You are grooming your bride. And the woman too, you are getting the best out of your husband. By the time you submit to the love that you see, and you are bringing out the best through respect. You know, when you respect your husband, the best of the man comes out. When you love your wife, the best of your wife comes out. Do you know why God said so? As unto a weaker vessel. Look at what I just read to you in Exodus. Moses came and stood up and helped her. Which area are you helping your wife? Which area are you helping your husband as a woman? You need to function. You know, there are some women, all they know is to spend their husband's money. They create opportunity for the man to throw away money. You know, and they throw them with that, the man begin to withdraw. The same thing with some men. God has blessed your wife. Instead of you to function with her, you create opportunity, begin to lie and collect that money from her. And when she now discover, you now find out that your marriage is no longer trustworthy, it becomes a challenge. These are the things that make people not to have a happy and a long-lasting marriage. That is shortening the life of marriages. And that is why we are talking about marriage killers. These are the things that is making marriage not to last. Because if you want a long-lasting marriage, a happy and a long-lasting marriage, this thing that we are sharing with you is a thing of concern that you need to look into and see how you can move your family and your life forward. I want to let you know, this is Reverend Simon Asemota and Pastor Grace Asemota saying, we love you. This is Christian Relationship Foundation. Don't go away. There are other information that will be coming up. Just continue. Stay tuned. We'll be back. And when we come back, we are going to be entering the concluding part of this program. Don't go away. We'll be back. God bless you. You are welcome back. This is Reverend Simon Asemota and Pastor Grace Asemota on Me and You Christian Relationship Foundation. I want to say thank God for your life, and we are so excited coming back to share thoughts with you. And I believe we still have just 1 point more and call it a day, because we have a lot, but we're going to take time and take months. We're going to be talking about this, and I wanted to know what you hear, you become.
Okay, so another one I want to talk about is be quick to forgive and quicker to apologize. Love forgives. Learn to accept apology. Freely forgive your spouse, past, present, and future offenses. Never refer to his or her past mistakes. Never go to bed with anger or unsettled quarrel. Marriage is two forgivers living together. Marriage is two forgivers living together. Be quick to forgive. Be quicker to apologize. You know, most time there's this five letter word that is a very strong word, that when you use it, it hits very fast. That is the word sorry. Sorry is five letter words, but it's very powerful to heal wounds. When you discover that your husband is angry, or there's something that you have done and is making him, or there are even at times you don't even know why he's angry, be very quick to say, I am sorry. Apologize, either as a man or as a woman. You know, most times when people say, ah, men find it very difficult to apologize. Depends. Any man that wants peace or joy in his home should learn to say, I am sorry. And sorry does not remove anything from you, whether as a man or as a woman. It does not remove anything. Because you want peace in your home, you want to be happy, you want your marriage to last, learn to apologize to each other. When you discover there are some people you try to pretend that all is well, and you know that all is not well. You come to the house, you fake to attend to people, but all is not well. Why not, instead of doing that, why not just say, I'm sorry? And then the whole issue is over. And some people will say, ah, he's always saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. He said, even the offense, the one for this present one, the one he has done now, the one that he has not even done, my husband will say forgiveness in advance. Forgive the person even before the offense will come. Because as for offense will come. The Bible makes us so that. It's so offense will come. People will offend you. The teeth and the tongue, they do fight, but I've never seen anyone go on transfer. You know, within the time I've still on earth here, I've never seen the teeth. So, I'm going to go on transfer today because the tongue is say, okay, I want to pack today. There is no relationship between us today. The both of them, they fight, they hit themselves. You know, the pain is there, and they continue with the relationship. And they are so, this, that is how husband and wife should be. You might be out there and say, oh, you don't know what my husband have done to me. He has hurt me so badly. What can somebody do to Jesus with those humiliation, a lot of things? But you see, even with that, he endured those humiliation and he still died for us. That today, many of us are free. Many of us have been delivered. Many of us are redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. So, but the Bible says, if God will mark iniquity, who can stand? There's none of us that can be able to stand. You see, but God so loves us that despite our offense or what we have done, he still has mercy. So the same thing as husband and wife. Learn to forgive. Say, husband and wife that want to have a happy and long last marriage are two forgivers that are very quick in forgiving. Because you know why? Your children are looking at you. You are a role model to the children. If there's offense, don't go to bed with an issue that you don't settle. I know that there are some people, it's like they have the ministry of malice. You know, you can stay for 2 years, for 3 years, for 4 years. Don't. I can't even see myself staying without not talking to my husband. Because when you're around my husband, there's only this, sometimes the way we say thing, and then you just have to laugh. Even when you try to pretend that and you want to, before you know, you just laugh. You know? So staying with that type of person, you want to stay 1 week, 2 weeks, I can't imagine, you know, staying like that. Even when somebody offends me outside, I just want to go home. Maybe by the time I discover my husband, it's only one word he will just say. And you see, all those things that person have said, the thing will just be a thing of the past, and I will just move on. So try to make friends from your home. Try to make your home an atmosphere of happiness, joy, and peace. When you make your home like that, the devil cannot penetrate. Because you know that when offense, when the enemy is trying to creep into your home, he's trying to disorganize you. He's trying to take away your joy, your peace. What do? Take it back. When you take it back, I tell you, there will be happiness in your home. Learn to say you are sorry. Settle the issue. And sometimes some people say, he's the one that offended me. He should be the one to call to apologize. Even when you know that he's the one that offended you, call him. Because sometimes some people might even do some sanity. They don't even know that they have offended the person. And then the other person will just be carrying long face. And the man is not looking at the long face and he's not even seeing you. What you do when you come back home after you have eaten, call, say, come, we went outside today. There was so thing you did and I didn't quite like it. And that one just put me off. He said, you'll be surprised. Mom said, I didn't even know I said something like that too. I didn't even know I offended. Please, I'm sorry. You know, I would not want to put you down like that. You are my wife now. You are my husband. Just make something light out of it. Don't make a mountain out of little thing that does not mean anything. You know, some people will come home and then instead of you to discover the man, discover the woman, you go and bring out your daughter. We went to Mr. and Mrs. So-so-so place house. I was trying to say something. My husband shot me down. Or my husband said this. My husband said this. You write it down. So writing it down have not solved the issue. What will solve it is for both of you to talk because you are friends. Your husband is not your enemy. Your wife is not your enemy. So call him. Talk to him. And I tell you, when you address the issue, he will tell you, I didn't mean it like that. I'm very sorry. My husband is always, well, one by ten, say, okay, I'm sorry. And that settles it. And you move on. Because the truth is that this life that you are living, you are not going to live it again. You are not going to live it again. So why not make good use of it? Why not enjoy your life? Why not bring some peace out of it? Don't try to. This is the season that we are celebrating Easter. There are some home now is on fire.
Because of rice.
My husband did not buy this rice.
Because
my
of
husband
rice.
Did not buy this chicken. My this one. My children, what are they going to? See, there's no need for all that. What you do, okay, this time was not like last year. Thank God. To God be the glory. I know that next year will be better. I know that things will be okay. Oh, this time I was able to buy fish. I know that next year he will buy chicken. Next year he will take us out. Don't make issue out of nothing. Just see it as, this is where we find ourselves now. There's no problem. Tomorrow will get better. When you have that mindset, I tell you, there is no way there will be no peace and joy in your marriage.
Wow, that's exciting. You know, when you were just talking, something came to mind. The Bible says, whatever I said before you eat, ask no question. Whatever I said before you. Now listen, Easter is not for rice, it's not for chicken. Easter is the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know where to spend it, please go to church, just take your Bible, kneel down there, and we know thank God for your salvation, that Jesus died for you, and he has given you the liberty. The Bible says there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So you are no longer under condemnation. And the Bible says, stand firm in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. Be not entangled with the yoke of bondage anymore. So you need to dwell on God's word. Take time to study God's word. It's not for rice. I always ask people, if it's Christmas, I always ask, is it your birthday? It's not your birthday. So the purpose of Jesus dying on the cross is not for rice or fine dress. It's for us to know that we have been redeemed. And the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord
say so.
So it's very important for us to know that. But thank you for what we just read, talking about be quick to forgive. And if you really want to have a successful marriage, you must have forgiveness in advance. Having accepted the one you married, then the next thing is to have forgiveness. As long as both of you are in the same house, you are from different backgrounds. There are some things my wife does, I don't like it. But you see, that's who she is. Now, I must learn to compromise. You must tolerance. Let me show you something. The book of Colossians, chapter number 3, verse 13. Let's look at what the Bible says, because I said the word of God is our standard and Jesus our example. Colossians chapter 3 verse 13. Forbearing one another, forgiving one another, if any man have quarrel against any. Now this Bible says quarrel. So as long as both of you are there, you are married, quarrel. You have quarrel. He said if anyone have quarrel against any, even as Christ forgive us, so also do ye. Do ye, he said, do it. You have to do it. Your wife will offend you. Sometimes I offend my wife. Me, I will say forgive, because this is what my father did not do. That's why marriage didn't work. So I will not practice what my father did not do. My father did not do it. So his marriage did not last.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to. My father married did not last. My father married last for like 16 years.
Mm.
I was just 16. That's 16 years. That was when his marriage last. And I'm celebrating 25. Woo! Mm. Bravo! And I tell you something. I'm going to be here. Until death do us part. So I've won. If you want to mark my mina, I just beat my father by a very strong margin. And
with nine.
And I'm telling you, I'm going 10. I'm going, and my children will do better.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to experience breakage. So you need to learn to say, I'm sorry.
Mm.
I'm sorry does not take anything from you.
No.
In fact, a man that asks for forgiveness shows strength.
Mm.
Forgiveness is strength. Arrogant pride destroys you. It destroys the career.
Mm.
When you begin to be a man that is being tolerated and not accepted in your home, then you die before your time.
Mm.
Look at what it says. Above all, and above all, these things put on charity, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule your heart, and to which also you are called into one body. And be ye thankful. That's what it says. Be ye thankful. You are called into one body. Be ye thankful. Thank God for the life he has given to you. Thank God for your wife. Thank God for your children. Thank you. Be ye thankful. I want to read another Bible verse. I think that one is in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 5. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 5. If you are there, wait for me. I'm on my way. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 5. I want to read this Bible verse. It will bless you. Look at what it says here. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 5. And it says, beside this, give all diligence. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge. And to knowledge temperance. And to temperance patience. And to patience godliness. And to godliness brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness charity. If these things be in you and abide, they make you that you should neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. They make you will not be barren in your marriage. Your marriage will be fruitful. It will be a happy and a long-lasting marriage. A happy and a long-lasting marriage. Not sad, a happy. Now listen, he said if it be in you, you will not be barren nor unfruitful. Now listen to me. The maturity of a tree is demonstrated by his fruits. If you say you are mature, let's see it by your fruit. That is why the Bible says if you want to know a man of God, you know a man of God by the way he brings up his family. You don't know a man of God by the crowd. A lot of you have been carried away with crowds. Up to the extent, some people will even go and do something so that it can be. Listen, we are not, this is a practical lifestyle. It's a lifestyle. A man cannot vomit what he has not eaten. He said, if you want to know a man of God, he must be a man of one wife, not a man of plenty girlfriends. Not a man with side cheek that will choke you and give you a knife and not love. Not a man with side cheek. A man with one wife. A man that raised the children well. A man that is easy to correct. Not a man giving to arrogance and pride. These are not the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit, look at what he said. He talked about, look at, they are just listed here. Knowledge, temperament. Lord. You are able to control yourself. Self-control, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness is given. Charity is given to it. Just like that. Our time is up. By the grace of God, when I come back next week, we'll be sharing and we'll be continuing. I leave information to give to you. This is Reverend Simon Asemota. I'm Pastor Greg Asemota. We are the coordinator of Me and You Christian Relationship Foundation. We have a marriage academy. My marriage academy is on. You can put a call through if you stay in the city of Abuja. Even no matter where you are, we can counsel you by video call. You want to marry, you register, then we start. We have counselors, people that are married for 30 to 40 years. They are part of this marriage academy. You will see my books and all other information. Please call or send us an email. We will respond to you. You can be a part of this marriage academy. You can benefit. We have books, After You Say I Do, Before You Say I Do. All of these things, material, is meant to bless you. We have a marriage academy. We also partner with organizations. I'm also the coordinator of None Shall Be Barren. Now, when we talk about non-shabari, I partner with organizations who are also in the business of in vitro fertilization. Scientists that are doing very well all over the world, I'm part of them. Now, why am I part of them? I want to see you fruitful, not barren. God said, none shall be barren. So, by the grace of God, you can have your own child, no matter how long you've been married. There are some things that you need to know. The information will transform you and give you the best. Another thing we do again is that my wife runs a school. It's called He Reigns. Jesus Reigns. He Reigns Academy. We have from crèche to secondary school. And by the grace of God, the body house, as God help us, will soon be on. You can be a part of it. You have children. You stay in the city of Abuja. We stay in Yanyan, Federal Capital Territory, in Abuja. So you can buy Veterinary Road and in Federal Housing Estate. You can communicate to us via the telephone or text. We will get back to you and you can locate us. We have a church. I also pastor a church. I do a lot of things. Why? Because dream come true in a multitude of business. A lazy man have no future. A lazy man have no future. If you sleep too much, you will dream bad dreams. So wake up and walk while you are alive. So I love you. And until we see you again in this station, I want you to keep your marriage alive. Mm. Trust and obey. And we say here, we say love and obey. There is no other way you can be happy in your marriage except you love and obey. Once your husband love your wife, wife obey your husband, happy, fulfillment, satisfaction, all of those things will come. Until I see you again in our next edition, God bless you. We love you. Thank you very much for always being a part of our program. God bless you. Thank you.